So the big question here is, why are there so many species in the tropics? The flip side of that is, why are there so few species relative to the tropics in the temperate zone?
So we're at Washington University's Tyson Research Center, located about 25 minutes outside of St. Louis, and just on the edge of the Ozark ecoregion. Today we're gonna visit one of a large number of forest ecology plots that are coordinated through the Smithsonian Institution in a global network known as the Smithsonian Forest Global Earth Observatory, ForestGEO for short.
Our plot here is 25 hectares, it's about 47 football fields, where we have every stem mapped, measured, tagged, and identified. And then our collaborators have done this at 23 other forest plots around the world.
The big question is, why are there so many species in the tropics and fewer species in the temperate zone, which really give rise to one of the most ubiquitous and awe-inspiring but also daunting biological patterns on Earth, and that's the latitudinal gradient and species diversity. With respect to a particular hypothesis that's been around since at least the early 1970s, that there may be specialized interactions among tree species and their natural enemies like seed predators, pathogens, herbivores, both above and below ground, that could explain why any one given species in the forest is disallowed from building up such high local densities that it essentially competitively excludes other species and causes the erosion of diversity. A lot of these processes are thought to be strongest or operate effectively or efficiently at the earliest life stages within forests, the seed, seedling, and sapling stages. The Smithsonian ForestGEO network really provides a unique opportunity to test these hypotheses because all of the census protocols, tree census protocols, are standardized across the network.
And so that's what we really took advantage of in our analysis. We were looking for those patterns where the adult trees are having a negative effect on their offspring. So here's Caria tomentosa, mockernut hickory. And you can see there's areas of high adult density, so that the size of the circle is related to the size of the tree. And you can see there's a cluster of adults here and not many young. The young tend to be over here away from the adults. And so this is one of those species that shows this strong effect of adults on young. And so it's not advantageous as a young sapling to be growing up underneath a large parent individual of the same species, because you're going to be attacked by the same enemies that are attacking that parent. What it allows is space for other species to come in. And so if this interaction is really strong, you get all these other species coming in and higher species diversity.
The second major question that we were interested in addressing was, does the strength of this process, this negative effect of adults on their own offspring, is it stronger for common or for rare species in temperate and tropical ecosystems?
And so it really begs this question, why are there more species in the tropics? But then, why are there so many more rare species? How are they able to persist?
One of the things that we know from a variety of studies is that many different ecosystem functions or services, like carbon sequestration from forests, or water purification, or the effects of plants on maintaining the diversity of animals, can really depend on the amount of plant species diversity or tree species diversity within a forest. And so given this link between species diversity in a forest and a variety of important ecosystem services that humans depend on, any process that's involved in maintaining diversity in a forest then immediately has many important and broad applications for environmental sustainability.